Good morning, students. Once again, the development of the gastrointestinal system, part 2, including the development of esophagus, stomach, and duodenum, are discussed in this part. Right. So, the development of the caudal or post laryngeal part of the foregut. So below the laryngotracheal groove, the remaining part of the foregut consists of esophageal, gastric, and duodenal segments. So that we are going to discuss in this part in detail. And two offshoots which are arising from the duodenal part are liver and the pancreas. These are derived from the duodenal part of the foregut. The spleen, through it, spleen actually it belongs to the hemopoietic tissue, and but it will be discussed here because it is derived from the mesenchyme of dorsal mesogastrium, right? So that's why we are going to discuss the development of the spleen along with these structures of foregut. So now coming to the esophagus. So it begins when the embryo is approximately 4 weeks old. Now this yellow thing is the foregut tube. So because it is derived from the yolk sac, we are coloring it with yellow. And approximately when the embryo is 4 weeks old, this respiratory diverticulum, also called as the lung bud, appears at the ventral wall of the foregut. This is the foregut and this is ventral wall of the foregut. So here at 4 weeks, this respiratory diverticulum will grow, will develop. And this part of the foregut is the pharyngeal part of the foregut. Then this has to be separated from this pharyngeal part. That means the digestive and the respiratory tubes should be separated. So that is done by the formation of a tracheoesophageal septum. So that means the trachea of the respiratory part and esophagus of the digestive part, they should be separated. So a septum called as tracheoesophageal septum develops, and that gradually will divide this pharyngeal part and the esophageal part from this tracheal part. Okay, so ventrally we are going to see the respiratory primordium that is going to give rise to the larynx, trachea, lung buds and all. And dorsally we are going to see the esophagus here. So the esophagus extends from the commencement of laryngeal diverticulum to the proximal end of fusiform dilatation of rudimentary stomach. So here in this image, if you see, this is the fusiform dilatation of the stomach, and this blue thing what you are seeing is the respiratory diverticulum. So it starts from this commencement of respiratory diverticulum and then it reaches the proximal part of the fusiform dilatation of stomach. So this is the esophagus, which is very short in the beginning, that is about at 4 weeks. Later on it increases in its length. So here if we see, it has increased in its length. It increases even more, that I have shown you in the earlier slides, the Carnegie stages 13 to 17, how the length of the esophagus and the stomach, the size and shape all have altered in all those stages that we have seen. Likewise, the esophagus is going to increase in its length. So now we'll see what are the relations here. So this part is esophagus, right? So dorsally it is suspended from the body wall by a dorsal mesentery, right? So this area all in the gray color is the dorsal mesentery, and that dorsal mesentery has got this fused dorsal aorta. Okay, so dorsally esophagus is connected to the dorsal mesentery containing the fused dorsal aorta, and ventrally it is separated from the developing heart and the pericardial sac by this respiratory diverticulum. Okay, ventral esophagus is separated from the upper part of developing heart and the pericardial sac by this laryngotracheal tube or the respiratory diverticulum. And then in this image we can see the lung buds here. So laryngotracheal tube and the lung buds are going to separate the esophagus from the developing heart and the pericardial cavity ventrally. Dorsally, we are seeing the dorsal mesentery with the fused dorsal aorta. And the lower part of the esophagus here, it is connected or it is related to the septum transversum. So this orange area what you are seeing is the septum transversum into which the liver has grown. So this septum transversum is going to give rise to the diaphragm. Okay. So the esophagus from the thoracic cavity it enters into the abdominal cavity through the opening in the diaphragm. So which is nothing but the derivative of septum transversum. So in the upper portion it is related dorsally to dorsal mesentery, ventrally separated from heart and pericardial cavity by this laryngotracheal tube and lung buds, whereas inferiorly or distally it is related to the septum transversum. Okay. And on each side of the esophagus there lies the coelomic duct. I have shown you that picture with the dorsal mesentery and the coelomic cavities. If you just try to recollect, so those coelomic cavities are nothing but the coelomic ducts into which the lung bud will invaginate and the lung is formed there. So that coelomic cavity will form the pleural passage. Okay. Then so we can say that the thoracic mediastinum consists of those structures which are contained within the ventral and dorsal mesoesophagus. So ventrally we have got the heart, pericardium, the laryngotracheal tube and the lung buds. Dorsally we see the aorta, right? So thoracic mediastinum has got those structures which are contained within the ventral and dorsal mesoesophagus. And at first the esophagus is short, but with the descent of the heart and the lungs it its length rapidly increases, and during the intraembryonic life it increases in its length, and final adult length is reached at the as the life continues, right? Then during elongation its lumen is obliterated. So this point I have already discussed, that from esophagus to the anus all the gut tube is temporarily obliterated for some time, and then with the process of recanalization the lumen is reopened, okay, or reformed. So so in the esophagus also the same thing happens. First the lumen is there, then it is obliterated, then through the vacuolization and recanalization process the opening is formed again. Where destruction of the central part of the epithelial plug here, the canal is or the lumen is reopened. Then histogenesis of the esophagus. The esophageal mucosa, two layers of cells are seen by the stage 15, Carnegie stage 15, or at 5 weeks of gestation you will see two cell stage. Then those cells become ciliated at the end of 10th week. Then stratified squamous are seen at the end of 5th month. Circular muscle is seen at the age of stage 15, and longitudinal muscle arrives a little later at stage 21. The myenteric plexus can be seen at 9.5 weeks and ganglion cells at 13th week. So where from this plexus and ganglion cells are occurring? From the neural crest cells. The splanchnic mesoderm gives rise to the muscle and other coats, that is the lamina propria, muscularis mucosa, muscularis externa, all these are seen. And muscles in the upper two-thirds of the esophagus, if you remember the histology, they are striated, and the lower one-third is smooth muscle. Now let's see some clinical considerations of the esophagus. So one important thing is the esophageal atresia. This occurs when the trachea and esophageal ridges, this is the tracheal ridge and this is the esophageal ridge, when these ridges they are too far dorsally, causing the upper esophagus to end in a closed tube. So this is one reason for the esophageal atresia, and this is usually accompanied by a tracheoesophageal fistula. A fistula is an abnormal communication between two tubes here. So esophageal atresia is usually accompanied by a tracheoesophageal fistula, and in which case, that is, if the fistula is present, the gut contents can be aspirated into the lungs and lungs after birth, causing inflammation, which that condition is called as pneumonitis, or even infection, which is called as pneumonia. So tracheoesophageal fistula is usually accompanied by pneumonitis and pneumonia after birth, and typically it is associated with polyhydramnios prenatally. Postnatally you will see these two conditions, whereas prenatally you can see the polyhydramnios. That means the fetus cannot swallow amniotic fluid and it accumulates in the amniotic cavity. So here, because this is a blind ending and there is no communication, the fetus cannot swallow the amniotic fluid. So whatever amniotic fluid is secreted by the amniotic membrane and all, that is accumulated within the amniotic cavity. And postnatally, the child will regurgitate, vomit immediately upon feeding, and if a tracheoesophageal fistula is present, there will be congestion in the lungs, right? Because of this fistula, the congestion in the lungs is seen. So that is esophageal atresia. So atresia and fistulas, here what are we seeing? This is the normal esophagus dorsally, and this is the trachea ventrally. Then atresia with distal fistula, that means the distal portion of the esophagus is communicating with the trachea, and here we are seeing the atresia. So atresia with the distal fistula. There can be atresia with double fistula, so wherein even the proximal and the distal portions of the esophagus are having a communication with the trachea. Atresia with atresia with proximal fistula. So here this is the proximal portion of the esophagus showing the fistula, and this is the distal portion. Then without fistula there can be only atresia, or without atresia there can be fistula, right? So these are the types of esophageal atresias and the fistulas. Then esophageal stenosis is one condition which occurs when the esophagus fails to recanalize. So recanalization, obliteration and recanalization of the entire gut tube, I have discussed in the earlier slides. So if the recanalization does not occur, then that leads to esophageal stenosis. And also this is also because the stenosis can be a narrowed lumen or a total obstruction, right? So that again it can result in polyhydramnios prenatally, and postnatally the child will regurgitate immediately, that is vomit immediately upon feeding. And however, there is usually not a tracheoesophageal fistula. In stenosis we do not find any fistula, so the lungs will usually not be congested. So congestion is not seen in esophageal stenosis, whereas in the atresia accompanied by tracheoesophageal fistula you will see the congestion of the lungs and subsequent inflammation and infection can occur in the lungs. Then congenital hiatal hernia is one more clinical condition related to the esophagus. So here this is the diaphragm, derived from the septum transversum. So the distal portion of the esophagus is related to the septum transversum, right? That means it is related to the diaphragm, and this is the esophageal opening in the diaphragm. Okay, through this the esophagus enters into the abdominal cavity. So this congenital hiatal hernia occurs when the esophagus fails to grow adequately in length. So in Carnegie stages 13 to 17, the length of the esophagus increases rapidly, right? So that increase in the length of the esophagus, when it does not occur, that means the esophagus is short, then too short, what does it do? It pulls the cardiac stomach into the esophageal hiatus in the diaphragm, right? Through this hiatus, it pulls the cardiac part of the stomach, and also the loops of small intestine, a part of the large intestine, and a spleen also can be herniated into the thoracic cavity. So what happens as a result of this? The compromised structure, the resulting compromised structure of the hiatus can allow other gut contents, usually the loops of small intestine, to herniate up into the thoracic cavity. So these are all entering into the thoracic cavity, and you can see that they are pressing over the left lung here. This is the left lung, and also onto the left side of the heart. So the compression effects will be there in this hiatal hernia. Okay, so this is because inadequate growth of the length of growth in the length of the esophagus. Then one more condition is cardiospasm or achalasia cardia. So in this, there is no mechanical obstruction, that is the stenosis or obliteration is not there, but there is neuromuscular incoordination of the cardioesophageal junction. So this one is the esophagus here, and this is the cardiac end of the stomach. So between them, a sphincteric action is there at the cardiac end of the stomach. So that actually, when the food reaches this area, that junction is opened, reopened, and it allows the food into the stomach, right? But if there is a neuromuscular incoordination, that means the absence of nerve cells here, so the peristaltic wave will reach this area, but it is because of the absence of the nerves, this junction is not opened, and the food is accumulated within this distal part of the esophagus, right? And this condition is called as cardiospasm. So what is happening here? Neuromuscular incoordination. So why does this cardiospasm occur? Due to congenital agenesis of nerve cells in the myenteric and submucous plexus of the esophageal wall. So within this esophageal wall, there is absence of myenteric and submucosal nerve plexuses, right? So that will result in the cardiospasm. So this when an x-ray is taken in this condition, this dilated lower end of the esophagus represents the head of the bird, and this cardiospasm, the area in the cardiospasm, will represent its beak. So bird beak appearance, when you see on an x-ray, you can suspect the cardiospasm or achalasia cardia, right? Now coming to the development of stomach. So stomach, it develops as a fusiform dilatation from the lower part of the foregut, and it starts developing at the end of the fourth week and beginning of the fifth week. So the lower portion of the foregut will form a fusiform dilatation like this. Okay, and this fusiform dilatation will have a ventral border. This is the ventral border, and this is the dorsal border, right? So end of the fourth week and beginning of the fifth week, this change will start. And next step is the dorsal border will grow rapidly than the ventral. So this dorsal border will grow rapidly than the ventral border. This is the ventral border. And this rapid growth will result in the formation of rudimentary fundus as well as this greater curvature. Okay, rudimentary fundic part is this one, and this is the greater curvature. So this is because of the rapid growth of the dorsal border compared to the ventral border. Then next what happens is this is the pyloric region here. Okay, so this pyloric region, because of the extreme growth of the greater curvature or the dorsal border, it will be pushed towards the ventral side. So here if you see, the pyloric part has been pushed towards the ventral side. Okay, and because of this, this ventral border becomes concave and it is called as lesser curvature, and this is called as greater curvature. The dorsal border is called as greater curvature and the ventral border is now called as the lesser curvature. Okay, so this is the pyloric part of the stomach. Then the ventral border, I told you the foregut is only the part of the primitive gut which has got both ventral mesentery and dorsal mesentery. So this is the ventral mesentery and this is the dorsal mesentery. So the ventral border is suspended anteriorly by this ventral mesentery or ventral mesogastrium, and this ventral mesogastrium is derived from the septum transversum, okay, which is the future diaphragm. So this ventral mesogastrium is derived from the septum transversum. Then what happens, from the duodenal part of the foregut, an offshoot is given off, that is hepatopancreatic bud, which gives the part of the pancreas and the liver gallbladder. So this bud, liver bud, when it enters into the ventral mesogastrium, this ventral mesogastrium is divided into two parts, the part between the stomach and the liver and the one between the liver and the body wall. This is the body wall here. Okay, so between the body wall and the liver, it is divided into one part and this is the other part. So that which is present between the liver and the stomach, that ventral mesogastrium forms the lesser omentum, and that which is present in front of the liver between the body wall and the liver, this forms the falciform and coronary ligaments of the liver. Okay, falciform and coronary ligaments of the liver are formed. Then this is the dorsal border of the stomach. So the dorsal border of the stomach is suspended from the posterior abdominal wall by a dorsal mesogastrium, right, which is the dorsal mesentery of the primitive gut. Now if you see in this image, this is the spleen. Spleen is developed in the left layer of the dorsal mesentery or dorsal mesogastrium. So under cover of the left layer of the dorsal mesogastrium, and the portion of the dorsal mesogastrium between the stomach and the spleen, this area will become the gastrosplenic ligament, and the one between the spleen and the body wall will form the leno-renal ligament later on. Okay, posterior body wall, we'll see the left kidney here. So the communication between or the connection between the spleen and the left kidney will be leno-renal ligament. So that is seen here. Okay, then now this is the embryonic position of the stomach. In the adult position, if you see, this ventral border, the lesser curvature is seen on the right side and greater curvature is seen on the left side. Now how does that happen? That occurs with the rotation of the stomach through a vertical axis. The stomach rotates towards the right side. You can see the arrow here. So this ventral border, this comes to the right side. So that the lesser curvature is seen on the right side, and simultaneously this dorsal border will come to lie on the left side. That means the greater curvature comes to the left side. So in this image, if you see, after the rotation of the stomach, see the ventral border here, it was there, it has come on to this side, and the right surface, actually here this is the right surface, right, and this is the left surface. So the right surface, it has gone and come to lie on the posterior side. So this is the posterior inferior surface. Now you should understand the nerve supply of the stomach. The right vagus is supplying the posterior inferior surface, and this originally left surface, it has come to lie anteriorly, right? So here this is the left vagus supplying the antero superior surface. So the rotation of the stomach is around a vertical axis and about 90 degrees, so that the ventral border comes to lie on the right side and the originally right surface goes on to the posterior side. So on the posterior side, and the original left surface comes to the anterior side, forming the antero superior surface. So that's how we can explain the nerve supply of the stomach with the rotation of the stomach. Then after the rotation, what happens? As a result of rotation of the stomach, the dorsal mesogastrium bulges down to grow and form a double layered sac extending over the transverse colon and the loops of small intestine like an apron called as greater omentum. So in this image, if you observe, this is the transverse colon and these are the loops of small intestine. This is the cut end of the dorsal mesogastrium. So in this image, if we see, the dorsal mesogastrium is attached along the dorsal border or the greater curvature, right, which now has been aligned on the left side. So this, after the rotation, it grows down, bulges and grows down, covering the transverse colon and the loops of small intestine like an apron, right? And this is called as the greater omentum. Okay, now where is the lesser omentum? Between the stomach and the liver, there is lesser omentum. So here in this image, we can see this is the lesser omentum, which is the part of ventral mesogastrium, whereas this is the greater omentum and this is the transverse colon. So this is the dorsal mesogastrium, which is forming the greater omentum, whereas the ventral mesogastrium, it is divided into two parts. I have told you, one between the stomach and the liver is the lesser omentum, and the one between the body wall, this is the body wall and the liver, in between them this is the falciform ligament, also there will be coronary ligament here. Okay, and one point you have to remember, the other gut parts, that is the midgut and the hind gut, do not show any ventral mesentery, only the dorsal mesentery is present. And the caudal end of the stomach separated from the duodenum by the formation of a pyloric sphincters. So here this is the pyloric part and this is the duodenum. So between them there is a pyloric sphincter. So that is genetical factors are involved in the formation of these sphincters. So any errors in this process lead to pyloric stenosis. Okay, errors in the formation of the sphincter, that will result in pyloric stenosis, that is narrowing or total obliteration of the pyloric canal. Then in this cross section, if we see, I just want to put a few points about the other ligaments of the liver. So here this is the stomach and this is the liver, in between them this is the lesser omentum. Okay, and this one here is the falciform ligament, and this is called as the free margin of the falciform ligament. So within this free margin of the falciform ligament, there lies the umbilical vein, and this umbilical vein is obliterated after birth to form the round ligament. So the line where the umbilical vein is present, that is obliterated and thickened to form a ligament. That ligament is called as round ligament of the liver or ligamentum teres hepatis. Okay, this one is called as ligamentum teres hepatis. And the free margin of the lesser omentum here, okay, between the liver and the stomach, this free margin connecting the duodenum and the liver, here this one, so this consists of the So here the stomach ends and the duodenum starts. This is the first part of the duodenum, right? So this is the free margin of the lesser omentum. So in this free margin, there lies the bile duct, portal vein, and hepatic artery, which is called as portal triad. So this free margin, what is the importance of this free margin? This forms the roof of the epiploic foramen of Winslow, which is the opening. Now this area is called as the lesser sac or the omental bursa, okay, which lies behind the stomach. So this lesser sac is connected with the greater sac. So except this area, rest of all the peritoneal cavity is called as the greater sac. So there is only one single communication between the lesser sac and the greater sac, that is through the foramen of Winslow. And that foramen is bounded or roofed by the free margin of lesser omentum, this one here, free margin of lesser omentum. Right, so that is the importance of the lesser omentum. Now what are the factors that are involved in the formation of the or in the rotation of the stomach? So one important factor is the rapid enlargement of the right lobe of liver. So here if you observe the size of the liver here and here, if you observe, it is rapidly grown. The right lobe of the liver grows rapidly and it settles in the right part of the abdomen, and so that the spleen gradually shifts towards the left side. That results in the rotation of the stomach, one factor which is involved in the rotation of the stomach. Then the other one is the omental bursa. So this one here is the omental bursa behind the stomach. So this gradually pushes towards the left side. The dorsal mesogastrium is pushed towards the left side, and then results in the formation of, what does this dorsal mesogastrium form? It forms the greater omentum. And then this apparent rotation of the stomach takes place due to an active growth process, so that the dorsal mesogastrium gradually shifts to the left from the dorsal border until it reaches its adult position, right? To attain the adult positions, this rotation is important. So that's why it occurs. So one is the rapid enlargement of the right lobe of liver, other one is the extension of the omental bursa towards the left side, pushing the dorsal mesogastrium towards the left side, and another one is an active growth process. Then histogenesis of the stomach. The mucosa and submucosa are seen by 8th to 9th weeks. Glandular pits along with the gastric glands, they are seen around 10 to 12 weeks time. In that glands, gastric glands as well as the pits are seen. The acid secretion is by 32 weeks. But if there is a preterm delivery, the preterm infants actually are capable of production of the acid. Secretion of the acid after 26 weeks of gestation. If the fetus is delivered after 26 weeks, it can secrete the acid. But the normal thing, a term baby, if we see from 32 weeks onwards, the acid secretion will start. Intrinsic factor is secreted at 11 weeks. Circular layer in muscularis externa is seen in 8 to 9 weeks, and rest of the layers, longitudinal and oblique, can be seen slightly later. Auxintic and zymogen cells are seen during 4th month, and renin functions in 5th month. This is the histogenesis of stomach. Coming to the anomalies of the stomach, one important condition is congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. So this is the common malformation present in about 0.5 to 0.1 percent of the infants, and this is characterized by a very forceful, that is called as projectile non-bilious vomiting 1 hour after feeding, that is when the feed or the food reaches the pyloric end, because there is stenosis here. See here, there it is totally blocked, so the emptying would not occur. The food is not going to enter into the duodenum, so then it results in projectile vomiting. Projectile vomiting is one important sign of the congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. And the presence of the bile would indicate post duodenal blockage represents the vomiting of bile, right? Presence of bile in the vomit will represent post duodenal blockage. And the hypertrophied sphincter can often be palpated as a spherical nodule. So this is an infant with the spherical nodule, represents the hypertrophied sphincter. And peristalsis of the sphincter can be seen or felt under the skin here. In this swelling, you can actually see or feel the peristalsis of the sphincter. That means the food is not going beyond that. That's why we will see this bulge. And the point that is to be noted here is stenosis is not, it is due to over proliferation. That is hypertrophy of the pyloric sphincter and not an error in recanalization, right? This point you have to understand. Recanalization has occurred. This is the normal one, right? Recanalization has occurred. But in congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, what happens is the sphincter muscle here, the muscle cells are hypertrophied, blocking this passage, okay? So it is not an error in recanalization, but it is an due to over proliferation of the pyloric sphincter, and it is more common in males than in females. So most likely has a genetic basis which is not yet determined, right? Now let's see the development of duodenum. So the duodenum above and including the hepatopancreatic ampulla, the duodenum develops from the terminal part of foregut, and below the ampulla from the proximal part of the midgut. Okay, so duodenum actually it develops from two parts, right? So this one, this is still here, this is the hepatopancreatic ampulla, okay? So till this above this level, including this ampulla, is derived from the foregut, okay? And just below that, this region, it is derived from the midgut, the proximal portion of the midgut and distal portion of the foregut, including the hepatopancreatic ampulla, that forms the duodenum. And the junction of the two parts is distal to the origin of liver bud. Okay, this is the liver bud here. So distal to the origin of the liver bud here, this is the line of junction between the foregut and midgut, which is nothing but the anterior intestinal portal. So what is this anterior intestinal portal? The junction between the foregut and the midgut is called as the anterior intestinal portal, and this corresponds to with the termination of the hepatopancreatic ampulla at the major duodenal papilla. So in the second part of the duodenum, we are going to see the major duodenal papilla, right? So that is the level of anterior intestinal portal. And this dual origin of the duodenum from the foregut and midgut is represented by the nature of its blood supply. See here, if we see, this is the branch supplying the duodenum coming from the celiac artery, superior pancreaticoduodenal. And then the distal portion is supplied by the inferior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which is coming from the superior mesenteric artery. Right, so this is the superior mesenteric artery, this is the celiac artery. So both the arteries of foregut as well as artery of midgut, the branches are going to supply the duodenum. Anastomoses occur between the superior and inferior pancreaticoduodenal arteries, which are nothing but the branches of celiac and superior mesenteric arteries. Then the primitive duodenum, this one, this is the primitive duodenum. It presents a loop with ventral convexity, okay? So this is the ventral convexity and dorsal concavity, okay, in the median plane. And the foregut segment of its ventral margin is attached to the septum transversum, by a ventral mesogastrium. This is the ventral mesogastrium of the or ventral mesentery. So we can call it as mesodeodenum. Okay, so this is a part of ventral mesentery. Then close to the anterior intestinal portal, here what happens? The foregut endoderm evaginates from the convex margin. Here from the convex margin it evaginates and forms a hepatopancreatic bud. This one is the hepatopancreatic bud. So the endoderm evaginates at the anterior intestinal portal, close to the anterior intestinal portal, and forms the hepatopancreatic bud. And this bud extends headwards and ventrally within the ventral mesogastrium. This is all the ventral mesogastrium, right? And the hepatopancreatic bud extends headwards and ventrally into the ventral mesogastrium. Then from this bud, the liver, biliary apparatus and lower part of the head of the pancreas develops. So here if you see, this one is the pancreatic bud and this is the liver bud. So the liver bud gives rise to the liver and the biliary apparatus, whereas this one is the pancreas. So part of the pancreas, lower part of the head of the pancreas develops from this bud. Then this is the dorsal concave margin of the duodenum. So the dorsal concave margin of the primitive duodenum is suspended from the dorsal body wall by the dorsal mesogastrium or mesodeodenum, we can say. And from this margin the dorsal pancreatic bud develops. So this one is the dorsal pancreatic bud. This is the ventral pancreatic bud, which forms as a part of hepatopancreatic bud. And here from the concave margin, dorsal concave margin, a dorsal pancreatic bud develops. And if you observe the position of this, it is slightly cranial to the ventral bud. This is ventral bud and this is the dorsal bud, right? So the dorsal bud is slightly cranial or cephalic to the hepatopancreatic bud. And this dorsal pancreatic bud extends dorsally and slightly headwards within the dorsal within the mesodeodenum and develops into the entire pancreas except the lower part of the head, which develops from the ventral pancreatic bud. Okay, except the lower part of. So in this image, if you observe, this is the ventral pancreatic bud and this is the dorsal pancreatic bud, which is slightly cephalic. And this dorsal pancreatic bud gives rise to the upper part of the head, neck, body and tail of the pancreas, whereas the lower part of the head, it is formed from this ventral pancreatic bud. And the duodenum, this is the vertical axis. Only the second part of the duodenum will rotate towards the right, and then you can see that this ventral bud comes to lie close to the dorsal pancreatic bud to finish off the entire pancreas. So before the duodenum reaches its adult position, it passes through three successive phases. One is rotation, then fixation and axial rotation. So these three changes occur before the duodenum reaches the adult position. So what are these three changes? First one is rotation. So where does this occur? When the developing large gut re-enters the abdominal cavity from the physiological umbilical hernia. So up till 10 weeks the developing large gut it actually is outside the body in a physiological umbilical hernia, and after 10 weeks when the abdominal cavity increases in its volume and it can take up the large intestine, then the intestines return back into the abdominal cavity. That we are going to see in the further classes anyway. So because of that, because of the return of the large gut into the abdominal cavity, the duodenum undergoes rotation towards the right side. So here if you see, this is the dorsal mesogastrium or the duodenum, mesodeodenum, and this is the duodenum. So here it undergoes rotation to the right side, Okay, so that what happens here? The pancreas and the duodenum will go into the retroperitoneal position here. Okay, secondary retroperitoneal position it goes. So just we'll see this. It pushes the loop of primitive duodenum to the right side and presses it against the body wall. As a result, the ventral convex margin of the duodenum forms the lateral border, and the original right surface becomes the posterior surface, right? So this was the right surface. This comes to lie posteriorly. So right surface becomes the posterior surface, and the ventral convex border becomes its lateral border. Okay. So first step is the rotation of the duodenum. Next one is fixation. So in fixation, what is happening? If you remember the earlier in the introduction part, I have told you about the secondary retroperitoneal organs. So the peritoneum covering the posterior surface of the rotated duodenum comes in contact with the parietal peritoneum of dorsal body wall or the posterior body wall. So then subsequently the two layers of the peritoneum disappear by zygosis. So in the beginning the duodenum was an intraperitoneal one. I mean it is covered by peritoneum. But after the rotation, the parietal peritoneum of the body wall and the peritoneum covering the posterior surface of duodenum, they come in close contact and they are disappeared by the process of zygosis. And hence, most of the definitive duodenum becomes non-peritoneal except the proximal 2.5 centimeters of the first part. So this is peritoneal, whereas rest of the duodenum will become non-peritoneal or secondary retroperitoneal organ. Right? And the last step is the axial rotation. So why do we need this axial rotation actually? We'll see. Due to differences in the growth of the duodenal wall, the second part of the duodenum undergoes axial rotation so that the hepatopancreatic bud appears in its posteromedial aspect and the dorsal pancreatic bud shifts more ventrally. So this rotation is called as axial rotation. I'll show you in an animation in the next slide. So the axial rotation, what does it do? It permits the head of the pancreas to meet with the rest of the organ and establish intercommunication between the duct systems of the dorsal and ventral pancreatic buds. So because of this rotation, the ventral pancreatic bud, which is forming the lower part of head of the pancreas, it meets with the dorsal pancreatic bud. And also the duct systems in both the buds, ventral and dorsal pancreatic buds, they intercommunicate. And during 8th week, the lumen of the primitive duodenum is obliterated by the proliferation of lining endodermal cells. And usually by the end of 3rd month, the lumen is recanalized. As anywhere else in the GID, I have told you in the beginning itself, the obliteration and recanalization process occurs in the entire GID, right from esophagus to anus. So duodenum also during 8th weeks, it is obliterated for a temporary period and later recanalized. And any failure in the recanalization will result in duodenal atresia. So here in this animation you see this is the ventral pancreatic bud. It is going posteromedial. Okay. And finally it is reaching this dorsal pancreatic bud here to form the pancreas. So that is how the rotation, axial rotation is occurring. So that the dorsal bud comes little ventrally and the ventral bud goes towards the posteromedial aspect to meet the dorsal pancreatic bud. Right? So this is the axial rotation of the duodenum. Also the stomach also we can see in this rotation of stomach. Right. Now coming to the clinical aspect. One is duodenal atresia. So on rare occasions, the duodenal lumen fails to recanalize and the portion of the gut above the obstruction is distended. Right, this is a normal healthy duodenum, whereas this is an atretic duodenum, and this portion proximal to this atresia is dilated and it is distended here. The atresia may affect any part of the duodenum, but more frequent below the hepatopancreatic ampulla. So that means the distal portion of the duodenum is more frequently affected. And the duodenal atresia may also be caused by an annular pancreas or due to vascular insult during fetal life. An annular pancreas is formed when there are two ventral pancreatic buds, so that I'll show you in the next slide. Or due to any vascular insult, that means ischemia, the duodenal atresia can occur. Now, it is a common cause of small bowel obstruction in the neonates and diagnosed by double bubble sign on an X-ray and ultrasound due to simultaneous distension of stomach and first part of the duodenum. So in this X-ray, what are we seeing? This is the image of a stomach. The gas in the stomach will show one bubble, and due to distension of the duodenum, the gas is also seen in duodenum. So first part of the duodenum. Usually in a normal X-ray, you will see only a gas shadow in the fundic region of the stomach. That is a normal X-ray. But in any obstructions like this, small bowel obstruction, especially the duodenal atresia, you will observe this double bubble sign. So when you see a double bubble on an X-ray, you can suspect duodenal atresia. And I was telling you about the annular pancreas. So the duodenal atresia may also be caused by annular pancreas. Now, what is this annular pancreas? Usually there is a single lobe of the ventral pancreatic bud. Sometimes there can be a bilobed pancreatic ventral pancreatic bud. So one lobe will actually rotate and reach this portion, whereas another lobe stays anteriorly, so that will form an annular pancreas like this. Okay, so this is the posterior part and this is the anterior part. And this annular pancreas, which is surrounding the encircling the duodenum, can cause obstruction. So that one more reason for duodenal atresia. Okay, so this finishes the derivatives of foregut. We are left out with the development of liver, gallbladder, pancreas and spleen, that I will discuss in the next part. Thank you.